We thank the Lumen Christi Institute, our main co-sponsor, and again, repeating thank you to the Catholic Lawyers Guild of the Jewish Judges Association of Illinois, which is here represented by its president, Judge Moshe Jacobius, the Decalogue Society of Lawyers, and the National Center for the Laity. Gary Anderson is the Hesburgh Professor of Theology at the University of Notre Dame. He holds his PhD from Harvard, and he has taught at the University of Virginia and Harvard, where he taught with John Levinson, our friend who spoke at a Lumen Christi event down at the University of Chicago last year. Professor Anderson's interests concern religion and the literature of the Old Testament Hebrew Bible, with a special interest on the reception of the Bible in early Judaism and Christianity. His interests span the entire Bible, but recently he has focused on the book of Genesis and the priestly literature. He studies and writes about the biblical narrative, canonical exegesis, biblical theology, Jewish culture and religion, and Jewish-Christian relations. He has won numerous awards, including grants from the American Philosophical Association or Society, the Lilly Endowment, the Institute for Advanced Study at Hebrew University. He most recently authored Charity, the Place of the Poor in the Biblical Tradition, winner of an Award of Merit for the 2014 Christianity Today Book Award, named as one of the 10 best religion books of 2013 by Religious News Service, and a finalist for the American Academy of Religion Awards for Excellence in the Study of Religion. And a copy of that book will be available for purchase outside afterwards, and Professor Anderson has promised that he will inscribe it for you. Now, owing to their familiarity with the topic, I know that many in the audience were hoping that we would be discussing Professor Anderson's 2010 book, Sin, A History, which also won the Christianity Today Book Award. But the need for interreligious dialogue has never been greater, and I think that it is thriving. And I just noticed the president of the Decalogue Society, Joel Shupak, who's here in the audience, and thank you for co-sponsoring. And I point out, as a lawyer, demonstrative exhibit number one, the latest edition of the JUF News. I turned through the magazine the other day, and there was not one, not two, but three articles on prominent Catholics. On page 12, there was an article on Archbishop Supich. On page 16, there was a two-page article in tribute to our late cardinal. And there was a two-page interview with Michael Garanzini, the Jesuit president of Loyola. And I think that says a lot about the thriving nature of interreligious dialogue, as is evidenced also by our event here tonight. I think the religious traditions hold in their treasure house a lot of things that can help society. And I think that tonight, as he did in his book, and like every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven, Professor Anderson will bring out of his storeroom treasures old and new. I'd like you to welcome Professor Anderson.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here, also to be here with a number of individuals who I realize come from the legal profession. This whole project began, curiously enough, when I was a fellow at the NYU Law School about 4 or 5 years ago in the Tikva Center there that was headed by Joseph Weiler, an amazing man who works in international law, now works in Italy, unfortunately. Is no longer at NYU, but it was a great experience to be a fellow at that law school, and it's equally a great honor to be here this evening. Let me say just a couple of things before jumping into my talk. Some people, or some audiences, and I think it's certainly quite understandable, people come to a talk like this with suspicions about the word charity, or its equivalent, certainly in Christian usage, almsgiving. I maybe just say just briefly a word about almsgiving. It's a corruption of a Greek word, eleemosyna, that comes into actually Italian and Spanish in a form much closer to its Greek original, limosina. But the word alms in English is a false plural. The S is not a plural, but it's from the corruption of this Greek word, eleemosyna, which translates, though we think of that as perhaps a Christian word, the Greek word was a result of the Jewish translation of the Hebrew Bible, and it typically translates one of two words in Hebrew, either chesed or tzedakah, the two most common words for charity in the Hebrew language. So the word alms in and of itself has a very deep Jewish background. But back to the point I was going to say about charity, something dramatic happens when we come into the modern age, roughly the 17th and 18th century across Europe, and that is the gradual but eventually complete movement of charitable activity, that is concern for the poor, from churchly or synagogal organizations to governmental organizations. That would be a whole nother lecture to recount what that was all about. But that's an important thing to bear in mind, because when people think of almsgiving, I think generally in the modern world, we think of dropping coins in the cup of a beggar, for example, which certainly happened in the medieval period, the late antique period, so on and so forth. But almsgiving or charity, classically considered within Christianity and Judaism, was a highly organized institutional thing. So, for example, hospitals, which began in the Byzantine period, were the result of Christian charitable interests. And charity was founded by and organized by lay people. They were referred to as confraternal organizations, of which we still have some left, actually, within Christianity itself. The Knights of Columbus, certainly at its origin, is something like a confraternal organization. And within Judaism, the Chevra Kadisha, the Burial Society, is a good example of the continuation of a confraternal organization designed to take part in good works. But this was the norm prior to the modern period. So a lot of the examples, even this image I have here up on this PowerPoint, are going to look and present charity from the perspective of the individual. But I think it's good to bear in mind that charity in the sources I'm going to be discussing tonight is an organized institutional project designed to ameliorate as best as possible the needs of those who suffer. Okay, so with that in mind, let me begin. It would be difficult to overemphasize the importance of charity within the Jewish tradition. All one has to do is turn to a Hebrew dictionary, and there one will learn that the biblical word for commandment, mitzvah, undergoes an enormous change when we move to the rabbinic period, roughly the time of Jesus and the early church. The term mitzvah develops a second meaning, not simply commandment, but that of giving alms. And this nicely reflects the fact that in rabbinic tradition, almsgiving had become the commandment. The dictionary itself gives voice to this very idea. The Talmud itself, too, puts this matter quite succinctly when it says, giving alms is equal to keeping all the commandments in the Torah. The importance of charity is confirmed in the writings of the Roman Emperor Julian, also known as the Apostate. Though he was raised in a Christian home, at the age of 6, he witnessed the brutal murder of his father and other family members. Forever turned off then to the claims of the Christian religion that had only become licit recently, Julian embarked on a project to revive traditional Greco-Roman religion. In one of his letters, he exhorts a pagan high priest in what would now be modern-day Turkey to provide food for the poor in order to combat the success of his Jewish and Christian competitors. And not only does he give this order, but as a sign of the seriousness with which he takes this matter, he also provides the food that's going to be distributed. He tells his priest, 1/5 of this is to be used for the poor who serve the priests, and the remainder is to be distributed by us to strangers and beggars. For it's disgraceful that when no Jew has to beg and the impious Galileans, that's his term for the Christians, support not only their own poor, but ours as well, all men see that our people lack aid from us. This is an amazing letter because frequently when you're studying the religions of the ancient world, it's hard to know whether what an ancient writer describes as the character of his or her religion is really the character of that religion or just what they wish was the character of that religion. And this little letter from Julian the Apostate shows us that not only did Christians claim to be charitable and emphasize charity, but it was in fact noticed by those who were hostile to the church. If we fast forward to our own day, we'll see that though we inhabit a much different world than that of Julian's, this particular feature of Judaism and Christianity remains visible for all who would care to see. In their recent book, American Grace, the political scientists Robert Putnam of Harvard and David Campbell of Notre Dame demonstrate that religious affiliation is strongly correlated with charitable giving. Well, naturally, the question arises as to why this would be the case. And here I must concede from the very beginning that I'm not a social scientist, and I'm not going to pretend this evening that I could wade through this impressive pool of data that Putnam and Campbell have assembled to discern why the data falls the way it does. I'm going to stick to what I know best, which is the textual world of early Judaism and Christianity, and try to discern from these sources just what motivated Jews and Christians to be so concerned about the state of the poor. Well, let me cut right to the chase. The answer to this question, that is why this intense concern for helping the poor, is really quite simple. For Jews, the act of providing for the poor is a form of avodah. That is a Hebrew word denoting the worship of God. Very important, I think, to emphasize here. We think of charity primarily in what I would call a horizontal fashion. That is, we're concerned primarily with the motives of the donor, huge interest in altruism, and we're interested in the results of the donation. Does it advance social justice? Both things very important. Don't mean to belittle them in any way. And both issues, of course, important in traditional Jewish and Christian thinking about charity. But what really motored ancient interest in charity was not so much those concerns, but rather what I call this vertical dimension. Charity, if I was to use Catholic language, as a sacramental action, a mode of being in contact with God. It's for this reason that Julian here in this letter we just looked at orders his priests to distribute the goods to the poor. He wants pagan lay people in the hinterland to associate the temple and Greco-Roman gods with the concern for the poor. Well, let's pause for a second on this point because I think it may take a moment or so to sink in. For most religious persons, I would assume, charity to the poor is thought to be a natural outgrowth of their faith, something like the relationship of a good education in success in a career. In both cases, what's primary, education or service to God, has some beneficial but still secondary effects. Emphasis on the secondary, that is, advancement in society or concern for the poor. But this is precisely what I don't mean when I say that providing for the poor in early Judaism or Christianity is avodah. In Jewish tradition, service to the poor becomes the privileged way of worshiping God. One can see this in one of our earliest sources for the importance of almsgiving, the Jewish apocryphal book of Ben Sira, a book known as Ecclesiasticus or Sirach. It's in the Catholic Bible, not in the Jewish Bible, though it's one of the apocryphal books that is cited quite extensively in the Talmud. Not many are, but it is. And our best evidences of the Hebrew text of Ben Sira were found in a keniza, that is a storeroom for sacred texts that was found in Cairo in the Middle Ages. So it was a book that was written by Jews and did continue to influence Judaism, even though it didn't make it into the Jewish Bible. Ben Sira lived during the early 2nd century BCE in Jerusalem and exhorted his students to take their responsibilities to the altar in the temple with utmost significance. Yet at the same time, he takes special care to correlate altar service with service to the poor. So he writes, the one who returns a kindness, gomel chesed, that is, enacts charity, provides a grain offering. And the one who gives alms, osei tzedakah, sacrifices a thank offering. The theology that's embedded in these brief lines is well reflected in a painting from about 1400 by Andrea de Bartolo of Siena. The painting is now can be viewed at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C., where I saw it. There I was struck by the label, which isn't quite accurate. It says Joachim and the Beggars. And you can see Joachim there on the your left, handing bread to beggars. In Christian tradition, Joachim is the father of the Blessed Virgin Mary and was considered to be a very pious Jew. And one can indeed see Joachim distributing bread. But a closer inspection of the image reveals that Joachim's wife is standing beside him, cheek by jowl, really. In fact, they're so closely juxtaposed one to the other, they look almost as though they are one agent. I don't think that's by accident. And she, in turn, is donating a jar of grain to the priest. So what the artist, I think, wants to tell us through this image is that through the hands of this couple, acting almost as one unit, God is served in two ways, by a direct gift to the temple and the distribution of alms to the poor. Service to the altar and the poor are correlative activities. This is also visible in the Book of Hours from the late medieval period, 15th century. This image comes from the Walters Gallery in Baltimore. Here one encounters God through two related actions, the sacrifice of the Mass, which we see at the very top of the image, and the provisionment of goods to the poor at the lower right. Almsgiving developed the prestige it did in Catholic culture because it was the privileged means of conforming one's life to the pattern of Christ. Just as he freely offered himself on your behalf without your having done anything to merit it, so you are to be prodigal in your efforts to assist the poor. In this action, more than any other, you are miming the very grace of God. I might say one other aspect of this image that actually, perhaps paradoxically, ties it to Judaism, though perhaps many modern Jews wouldn't recognize it. On the bottom, we have individuals being lifted out of what clearly is purgatory by an angel, and they're being lifted out of purgatory by these two modes, that is, the saying of the Mass and the giving of alms. The giving of alms as a mode of lifting souls out of purgatory comes right out of the book of Proverbs. A famous line in that book says, tzedakah, that is charity, tatzil mimavet, delivers someone from the realm of the dead. Here we can see it being enacted right in this image. Now, what's curious is that most of what I will speak about tonight will be Christian borrowings of Jewish ideas. But because charity and its functions were so close within Christian and Jewish civilization, when we get, for example, to medieval Spain, one of the practices of Catholic Christians at that time was individuals worried about the state of their soul after death would write into their wills that a significant portion of their estate be distributed to the poor as a means of assisting them to the world to come. They weren't going to get there on the merits of their own good works. They needed more good works, and this was the good work privileged above all good works. So one would leave one money in the will to be distributed to the poor to assist the journey of the soul to the world to come. We find the very same phrases in these Latin bequests, in Hebrew bequests from the same period, in medieval and late medieval Spain. And the borrowing there reflects a very similar approach to almsgiving. I might mention, just as an aside, when I was beginning this whole project, I was reading, I think more by accident than design, but Stephen Greenblatt's book, Hamlet and Purgatory, which isn't a greatly titled book because only the last two chapters are about Hamlet. Most of the chapters are about purgatory and the run-up to the Reformation and how charity becomes a contested category in the Reformation. But in the preface, he remarks that while he was writing this book, His father had recently passed, and Stephen Greenblatt was raised in a religious home but was a secular Jew, so his father was very concerned that he wouldn't say Kaddish for him after his death. And Greenblatt mentions that in the Jewish tradition, if the father doesn't think the son is going to say Kaddish, he will leave money in the will so that someone will say Kaddish for his soul, because Kaddish is important for the journey of the soul to the next world. And Greenblatt said a couple of things in the preface that were very interesting. Scholars of Judaism realize that the importance of the Kaddish prayer is a rather late innovation in Judaism. It's not Talmudic, but medieval, and probably, it's arguable, but many Jewish scholars would argue, is influenced by Christian thoughts about purgatory. It provides a Jewish counterpart to Christian purgatorial notions. In any event, Greenblatt mentions this, but also mentioned that the study of purgatory renewed his interest in saying Kaddish, and in fact, he went that year and said Kaddish for his father. So it was a nice little ecumenical touch. But one wouldn't imagine, at least looking at this image, at least at first blush, that it would have any relationship to Judaism. But I might say, just as my last footnote on the matter, I found this image in a footnote in Greenblatt's book. So back to the point. Here, the point I wanted to make here was the linkage of the sacrifice of the Mass to almsgiving. In other words, almsgiving having this deeply sacramental avodah character. It's hard for me not to link these two images to an often cited homily of St. John Chrysostom, a well-known late antique theologian and preacher who was active in the late 4th century and hailed from Antioch. He begins this particular sermon by acknowledging the honor that his congregation has shown the altar during the service that Sunday. The altar, he says, is worthy of veneration because it receives Christ's body during the sacrifice of the Holy Mass. But, Chrysostom continues, this is not the only altar to be found in Antioch. Whenever you see a poor man, he adds, after Mass, imagine that you see in this poor man an altar as well. When you meet a beggar, don't insult him, rather reverence him. These words of Chrysostom are not the result of a homiletic excess, but rather reflect the deeply sacramental character of the charitable deed. Well, let's pursue this a little deeper. In order to do that, we'll need to pause for a second on the concept of an altar and how it functions anthropomorphically in the temple. That is, anthropomorphically is a term scholars use to talk about religious language that uses images from human life in order to understand divine life. Though most of us have been raised good Thomists or Maimonideans, and as such have been raised to believe that God is beyond any material need, the concept of a temple requires that we temporarily suspend those philosophical worries. For the temple in the Bible is the place where God dwells, and as such, he's provided with a throne to sit on, a lamp for seeing, and an altar where his savory food is prepared. I like to say when I'm teaching this at Notre Dame that the altar functions, so this image probably won't, maybe doesn't already doesn't work, but certainly won't work probably 5 or 10 years from now, functions something like that tube in Star Trek TV show where one could be miraculously beamed up from one domain to the other. The altar, in biblical thought, is that spot where meat, grain, and oil can be directly transported from heaven to earth. So what happens when we take this anthropomorphic image, anthropomorphic because it presumes that God's hungry, and this is the mode by which we provide him with foodstuffs, what happens when we take this anthropomorphic image and carry it over to almsgiving? If the altar has the special capacity of being able to convey food to God, then the hand of the poor similarly must be able to transfer funds from earth to heaven. And in fact, Jewish beggars in the land of Israel in late antiquity used to address their potential patrons with the words zechibi, that is, make a deposit to your heavenly treasury through me. And so the idea of a heavenly bank was born, and along with it, the idea that making a deposit to this bank was like making a loan to God. Let's pause for a second on this notion of alone. As you may recall, the command to assist the poor in the Bible is expressed in financial terms. In fact, creditorial terms. When you lend money to my people, meaning the poor among you, do not act toward them as a creditor, exact no interest. In other words, charity, according to this biblical law, was a no-interest loan designed to preserve the dignity of the recipient here, the presumption being that they had fallen on times just temporarily when the wheel of fortune turned and things were better, they would be able to pay back the person who assisted them. So that's the book of Exodus. Now, let's go to Ben Sira, a book that written probably maybe as many as 1,000 years after the book of Exodus. He's well aware of this biblical commandment, but he also appreciates the risks that are grounded in this commandment. In other words, when you make a loan, the presumption is someone's going to pay you back. But of course, that doesn't always happen. So here's what Ben Sira has to say, reflecting on this obligation to give a loan. He says, many will regard their loan as a windfall and cause trouble to those who help them. Though they speak deferentially when requesting the money, they become indignant when repayment is due. As a result, Ben Sira concludes, many refuse to lend, not because they're mean at heart, but rather they are afraid of being defrauded. Very reasonable assessment of human nature, we might want to say, on the part of Ben Sira. He's urging people to take the commandment seriously, but to go into this financial arrangement with your eyes wide open. Now, here's where things get interesting. If these warnings are true of borrowers, even in the best of circumstances, then one would expect Ben Sira to be even sterner when he addresses the problem of the truly down and out. In other words, if just the ordinary Joe on the street, or Jane, don't want to be unfair to women here, they can fall into hard times as well. Joe or Jane on the street approaches you for a loan, someone that you know, you have reason perhaps to worry, but you know them in the past to be persons of means and have reasonable suspicions that in the future they'll be able to pay you back when things right themselves in their financial arrangements. But what about the truly down and out? One might think that Ben Sira would say, don't give them anything. But instead, he commends his students to disperse their funds without a moment's forethought. Lose your silver, he says, for the sake of the poor. Lay up your treasure in heaven. There we get this phrase, zechibi, I mentioned earlier, and something that will appear, of course, in the New Testament often, for there it will profit you more from gold. Okay, here we have a real puzzle that's worth thinking about. Where does this confidence come from that Ben Sira has? Why is it that he can be so realistic about the dangers of helping a friend in need with respect to what happens when you loan money? But when we're talking about the truly down and out, all those worries disappear, and he speaks with absolutely utter confidence as to what you ought to do. That is, you must help them. You must lose your money, as he puts it. Well, the answer I want to suggest lies in a rabbinic midrash, that is a rabbinic interpretive text. Let me just add here as a parenthetical point that I think this is perhaps the most important text we're going to look at this evening. If there's one text that in fact you would want to remember, it would be this one. And I put it on the handout, should have been on your chairs. In this particular tradition, Rabbi Gamaliel is approached by a Roman citizen and questioned about the rationality of his holy book. Can it be true, this Gentile asks, that your God commands you to give to the poor without a moment's hesitation? That's Deuteronomy 15. Someone who conducted his efforts in this fashion, this pagan reasons, would be out of money within days and in need of assistance himself. And to this, Rabbi Gamaliel then responds, and here reading from the handout, Rabbi Gamaliel asks, well, what if a man appeared out of nowhere and asked you for money? Would you give him it? The pagan replied, "No, of course not. But what if he brought you a deposit as collateral?" He replied, "Of course, that would eliminate the risk." "Okay then, what if this potential borrower brought you a commoner to co-sign?" Maybe like a Notre Dame professor. He replied, "I wouldn't issue the loan." "But what if, let's say, the governor of Illinois himself co-signed?" Well, the Roman would say, "By all means, his word is as good as gold." I don't know who the governor of Illinois is, but I always try to add some local color here to my manuscript. But here's the important point. Here's when Rabbi Gamliel gets down to brass tacks and explains the logic of the biblical commandment. He says, "Well, then, isn't scriptural logical? If you, just using ordinary human reasoning, will issue a loan when the governor of Illinois co-signs, how much more willing should you be to issue that loan when he who spoke and made the world agrees to co-sign? What better person could you have co-signing on a loan than God Almighty? For scripture says," and here is the punchline, "he who is generous to the poor makes a loan to God, and God shall surely repay what he owes." That's why Ben Sira was so confident about the reason why you should be unstinting in your generosity to the truly down and out, because now you're not engaged in ordinary economic activity, you're engaged with God. That's the sacramental avodah notion I have been trying to hammer home. It'd be difficult to exaggerate how important the theology of this proverb was for ancient Judaism, Christianity, and eventually even Islam. I provided a number of texts on the handout. We're not going to go through all of them, but they're all to the same point of casting help to the poor in the idiom of a loan, with the understanding that God is the co-signer and he will be the one who will guarantee repayment in the future. The evidence for understanding charity in this fashion is quite impressive in terms of its religious breadth, Jewish, Christian, and Muslim, and chronological depth as well, from the 2nd century BC with Ben Sira up to the 7th century, going to Islamic sources, and indeed, of course, even beyond. And the reason for the choice of this particular metaphor is grounded in the fact that charity is considered a form of avodah, that is, serving God. Okay, so much for the first two points I wanted to say this evening, that charity is a form of worship, and in order to concretize the way in which this worship works, God is addressed or brought into the picture by virtue of this metaphor of the loan and funding a treasury in heaven, an image, as I mentioned, that's quite important in the preaching of Jesus, especially in the Synoptic Gospels. But now for a question that I'm sure weighs heavy on the minds of some. Is this metaphor of funding a treasury in heaven worthy of the modern person's admiration? And here, if you remember what I said at the beginning of my talk, creep in the modern concerns about charity, the two major concerns being altruism and social justice. So because altruism weighs so heavily, giving without any thought of a return, the treasury in heaven seems to be a great offender against that principle. And modern persons find this mode of thinking of charity as to be without redeeming value. So when I've shopped this idea around to different focus groups, if I can put it that way, I have found on more than one occasion that the reaction from my audience is not altogether positive. Many are troubled by the idea that charity to the poor in this scheme seems to be motivated by an element of self-interest. Most people are far more comfortable with the wisdom of the rabbinic sage Antigonus of Soko, who said, quote, "Be not like servants who serve their master on condition of receiving a gift," end of quote. But let me caution before despairing of the tradition I have just laid out. The first thing to be borne in mind is that these financial metaphors come from the book of Proverbs in the Bible, And Proverbs, it must be emphasized, vary considerably in meaning depending on the context in which they are applied. Let's consider, for example, a very famous proverb, one that we've already alluded to, Proverbs 10:2. And this is my paraphrase. Material treasuries provide no benefit, but treasuries funded by charity, that is, treasuries in heaven, funded by charity, deliver from death. Okay, what is this proverb about? The question that stands behind this proverb is very a basic one. How should we save for the future? Imagine that by some happy accident, you become heir to an enormous sum of money. Rather than giving in to the urge to spend it immediately, you ponder how these funds might be invested to provide you with an endowment for the future. In front of you are two advisors. Warren Buffett, who needs no introduction, the famous investment guru from Omaha, and the Baal Shem Tov, the 18th century charismatic tzaddik, who was famous for emptying his pockets at the end of every day for the poor so that he could wake up the next morning wholly dependent on what God would provide him. Mr. Buffett speaks of the prospect of a slow but inexorable set of gains over time that will guarantee you a safe and secure retirement no matter how long you lived. That's one option of where to plant your money. The Baal Shem Tov, on the other hand, argues that God created the world out of charity, and as a result, prosperity in the future is going to depend on a way of riding those currents. Though it's technically correct that the Baal Shem Tov would be building on your tendency for self-preservation, and the act of funding a treasury in heaven would have an element of self-interest to it, I think if we think of the matter against this background, it's hard to imagine that the Baal Shem Tov telling us about the treasury of heaven can be conceived of as simply that, pursuing our own self-interest. It's rather expressing, I would want to suggest, a belief in the love of God and how it organizes and orders the world. To the Christian, of course, with respect to this proverb, there's something fundamentally cruciform about all of this. Acquiring a treasury by giving away one's money sounds a lot like losing one's life in order to gain it. And just as the logic of the cross is not so much the motivation for Jesus' actions in the Garden of Gethsemane, in other words, he doesn't say, I'm going to die so I can be raised to new life, so I think with respect to this image, with respect to charity, the same thing would apply. In sum, I would like to suggest that the way I've proposed for reading this proverb provides us with a deeper set of insights than those of Antigonus of Soko. For however salutary it might be to serve a master without thought of reward, most of us, I think, would at first want to know the character of that master prior to dedicating such efforts. There is, I would contend, a deeper human desire to know that the world is a place formed and guided by charity, that giving to one's neighbor is not simply a Kantian duty, but a declaration about the metaphysical nature of the world we inhabit. I like to say, wrote an article in America Magazine a couple of weeks called The Metaphysics of Money, that the notion of the treasury in heaven is more about metaphysics than morals. It's telling us about the nature of the world more than serving as a mode of inspiration to give. Charity, in short, is not just a good deed, in this construal, but a declaration of belief about the world and a declaration of belief about the God who created it. So that's my third point this evening, and so now you have it all. Charity is service to God, avodah, service to God imagined as a loan to God, and that loan, I've tried to suggest here, that funds a treasury in heaven at least I would want to claim, is a redeemable idea, because its primary function here is to tell us and the world something about the nature of the created order. Well, let me say just a little bit more on this point. We've seen that a gift to the poor is imagined as a loan to God. In conventional economic circumstances, making a loan involves risk. The housing debacle of 2008 brought this point home with a vengeance. When my wife and I refinanced our home then, my lender gathered all kinds of information about our financial holdings, our employment, the valuation of our home. They even looked into the quality of the neighborhood we lived in. The reason for doing this is the bank wanted to assess the risk that they would undertake if they loaned us the money. For when they offer us the loan, they express not only a faith in us and our property, but they act on that faith. Or stated somewhat differently, by making this loan, they were making a statement about our neighborhood and who we are. A creditor, then, is a believer in the full sense of the word. And the word creditor, in fact, not by accident, comes from the Latin credere, to believe. Think of its cognates, creed, creedal, credible, incredible, and so forth. Creditors are fittingly called believers because they put their money, we might say, where their mouth is. It would never be enough for a banker just to say he believes in you. The customer wants to know whether this belief has teeth. So for charity to the poor. And I think that's the punch of what Rabbi Gamaliel says about loaning to the poor. It's a way of putting into action what you profess to believe about the God you worship. So for charity to the poor, why is it, one might ask, that the life of Mother Teresa has moved so many people? And not just Christians, but Muslims, Hindus, Jews, and even non-believers. I would suggest that her popularity rests in the fact that she enacted a kind of faith that most of us can only dream of. But I also would want to contend that it's not just admiration for her faith that attracts our attention, but the statement that her life makes about the character of the world, the metaphysics, if you will. Though all appearances would suggest that it's Wall Street that makes the world go round, saints like Mother Teresa or the Baal Shem Tov make a powerful counterclaim. In serving the poor, they not only provide concrete material help, but they also reveal to us the hidden structure of the world. Steven Pinker, the famous scholar from Harvard, once expressed dismay that the world showers such esteem on Mother Teresa in light of the far greater good that philanthropists like Bill and Melinda Gates have achieved. Gates, Pinker writes, crunch the numbers. Here I have Pinker down below. And determined that he could alleviate the most misery by fighting everyday scourges in the developing world like malaria, diarrhea, and parasites. Now, it's important to note that Pinker never explains how he knows that the Gates established their foundation on these utilitarian principles. Perhaps the Gates' motivations, in fact, were quite different. And in the remarks that follow, I want to be clear, I'm not going to say anything negative about the Gates and what they've accomplished. I hold the Gates in great admiration. My beef in what follows is going to be the commentary that Pinker provides in his comparison of Mother Teresa with Bill and Melinda Gates. Let me begin by suggesting that utilitarian value is not the only index for the accomplishments of charity. For however much the Gates might give away, let's say they give away $25 billion. Maybe they've already given away that much, I don't know. Their daily life remains, by and large, unaffected. They remain one of the wealthiest couples in all of America. Mother Teresa, on the other hand, gave up everything she had to serve the poorest of the poor. Her total and unreserved trust, to quote Rabbi Gamaliel put it, he who spoke and the world was created. It's a truly impressive enactment of faith if there ever was one. Now, Pinker wisely concedes that it's unlikely that his praise for Gates will win him more admirers than those of Mother Teresa, but this, he claims, is because our heads can be turned by an aura of sanctity, distracting us from a more objective reckoning of the actions that make people suffer or flourish. Mother Teresa, he asserts, was the very embodiment of saintliness. White clad, it's almost as though he's looking at this slide, but I don't think he was. White clad, sad-eyed, ascetic, and often photographed with the wretched of the earth. That's a quote from Pinker. But this is an amazing reduction, I would want to suggest, of the supreme gift Mother Teresa gave the world. When she started her religious order, the entire premise of the organization was the gift of one's total self to the poor. One well-educated Indian professor of the sciences, when asked about her admiration for Mother Teresa, said, "I'm an unbeliever, but I feel I need an anchor, and Mother Teresa is an anchor, or that anchor." But let me reiterate, I'm not belittling the accomplishment of the Gates Foundation. It's truly extraordinary and worthy of our admiration. What I've tried to do, though, in the last minute or two is explain why an Indian professor of the sciences, an unbeliever like Pinker, might find in Mother Teresa an anchor for her life. What I've tried to suggest is the affection for Mother Teresa can't be explained on utilitarian calculation, the support of this type of explanation that Pinker prefers. Rather, the generosity of Mother Teresa, like that of the Baal Shem Tov, became praiseworthy because it was a statement about the nature of the world that God had created. There's this profound evangelical quality to charity. Not so much evangelical used here generically to encompass Judaism as well. In other words, it casts forward to the world what the character of the world is. And so here, I think, is the main point I would like to make. Whether we are believers or unbelievers, I think it's fair to say that most of us want an account of human goodness that goes deeper than utilitarian calculation. We want to believe that the world is good and at least in the long run rewards a life of charity. So the reward here isn't so much at the point of motivation. That's what moderns always worry about. But the importance of the reward is it tells us something about the type of world God has made, who God is, right? The reward is there because that's who God is. That's the kind of world we inhabit. It doesn't look like that type of world. Of course, we need faith to see it that way, but that's what that's the work the Treasury in Heaven imagery does. The holy men and women of the synagogue, church, and mosque help us to see the world in that fashion. And that is the deep reason I want to suggest why the financial metaphor of funding a treasury in heaven became so significant in the ancient world for Jews and Christians. The important point for these thinkers and religious individuals was not so much what are they going to gain from charity, though an element of that remains, but rather what does charity tell us about the character of the world? So let me conclude. We began with a quotation from Julian the Apostate regarding the striking fact that Jews and Christians were extraordinarily generous to the poor. This led to our first question. What might explain their motivation? Our answer was simple. Service to the poor was service to God. The poor became walking altars where one could meet God. This led to a second question. What precisely does this analogy mean? I suggested that just as the altar in front of the temple served to transfer food from heaven, so the hand of the beggar functioned with respect to coins. Jewish beggars, we observed, addressed their patrons with the word zechibi, acquire a zechut, acquire a merit in your heavenly bank account through me. Then came the third and most important question. Is such a mercantile metaphor really appropriate to the religious life? I suggested that behind this metaphor resides the image of the debtor and creditor. When one gives to the poor, one becomes a creditor vis-a-vis God. And every creditor, I took pains to point out, is at base a believer. Loaning goods to the poor expresses a belief about God and the world he has fashioned. It's not a world that's governed by those who hoard their goods in hope of a better tomorrow, but rather it's a world in which those who want to secure a better future are going to share their goods with others in need. That's the type of world we live in. This is the reason I've suggested that Mother Teresa has such broad appeal. People want to believe that. Pinker claims that the wider public has been duped by the aura of her sanctity, and as a result has failed to do the proper utilitarian calculus. But human beings, I've tried to suggest, desire more than a calculus of material accomplishment. We want a, to use the German term, Weltanschauung, that is, a way of viewing the world that provides our lives with an anchor. Charity to the poor this evening, I've tried to suggest, is that very anchor. Thank you.